we did a bunch of factoring, right? We factored a bunch of big numbers. We did the divisibility test to figure out how to factor. And then we talked about the greatest common divisor and the least common multiple. We said the greatest common divisor, or the GCD, of two natural numbers is the largest natural number that divides both. So we said to find the GCD, we take the common prime factors, and then we multiply those prime factors to the smallest power that appear in the prime factorization of both, right? So then we did this example, find the GCD. So who can remind me what the steps are for this? If you have to find the GCD or you have to find the LCM, the steps are the same. We have to find the prime factorization of both, write those down, and then we're taking the prime factors that are in both to the lowest power that they appear, right? The prime factors that appear in both to the lowest power that they appear. Then here was the quiz last class, right? So somebody walk me through it. So we're doing a prime factorization of each. And you said 66 is 6 times 11. 6, is that prime? Not quite yet. So it's 2 and 3. Okay, and what were you going to say, Bailey?
11 and 10.
11 and 10.
2 and 5.
And then 2 and 5. Okay, so let's write it. We have 66 equals 2 times 3 times 11. And we have 110 equals 2 times 5 times 11. I like to write it in order so I can see it a little bit more easily. So now I'm taking the prime factors that appear in both to the lowest power. So 2 appears in both, and it's 2 to the first power, and 11 appears in both. Right? 11 to the first power. 3 is not in both, 5 is not in both. So the GCD equals 2 times 11, which is 22. Okay, so that was the quiz. I think some people just prime factored and didn't do this part. Some people, when they prime factored, they forgot about that 11 somehow, so they ended up saying 66 equals 2 times 3, forgot the 11. So pay attention to those details, right?
Did you have to do equals 22?
You could have done 2 times 5, right? But again, if you want to look at your quiz, you can swing by my office after class. Okay, number 7. GCD of 675 and 1125. So somebody help me out with the prime factorization of both. What goes into both of those?
Five.
A 5. They both end with 5, right? So you can divide them both by 5. Do you guys want me to bring in my calculators so you guys can use them during class to get used to using them during the test?
So we can't use ours for the test?
I don't think so.
Not use that you check for like whatever, like you think you have something in there or whatever, you can't use the test.
So the reason I like the dollar store calculators is because it might be 6.2, 6.3. We're going to talk about rational numbers. We're going to talk about adding and subtracting fractions, multiplying and dividing fractions. And most calculators can do that for you. But that's a skill that I think you should have. So if your calculator has like a fraction button, can't use it. So that's why I just have everybody use the dollar store calculator so that you can all just be on the same page. Because I think even whatever calculators you guys are using, Andrew, does yours have, yours probably has a fraction, does yours have trig stuff? I can't see that.
Yeah.
Sign? Yeah. So if it has trig stuff, it usually has a fraction. If you do want to practice, a good place to practice is like your iPhone, because if you pull up that calculator, it is just the basic. But I can bring in the calculators into class if you guys think that would help. Yeah? Somebody want to go to my office and get those calculators?
I can.
Okay. So if you go into the right, there's just a little red and black bag on the ground to the right. Will you just make sure you lock it after? Thank you. Okay, so 675 divided by 5 is 135. 1125 divided by 5.
They both 25 to.
So we can divide both what we just got by 5. So let's do 675 by itself. What's 27? 9 times 3. 9 is 3 times 3. So can I write 27 as 3 cubed? Is that okay? If you need to write 9, 3, and then 3 is 3 and 3, that's fine. Okay, so I like to do the factor tree, but I think it's best to summarize it and make sure you're not forgetting anything. Does anybody want some of these dollar store calculators so you can practice with the calculator you'll be using on a test? But again, I'd like to reiterate a lot of the topics we're talking about in this class. I met with somebody from the education department. There is a test you have to take to become certified to teach, and a lot of this math is on there. There is, and they give you exactly like the dollar store calculator. So I'm not just trying to be mean to make you guys know how to add and subtract fractions, right, by yourself. Also, if you want to, I said last class, if you want to go to graduate school for anything, basically you have to take the GRE, and there is a math portion of that. And it's literally, it's on the computer, but you can pull up a calculator that looks like this, and that's it. That's all you get. So I know this seems very rudimentary compared to your scientific calculators, but I'm not just being mean. If you want to go to grad school, if you want to get an MBA, if you want to get a master's, you will have to take the GRE. Okay, so let's summarize. 675 equals 5. So let's do it smallest to largest. So I'm going to go through and circle to make sure I'm not missing any of them. Once you get to the bottom of a branch, that is a prime factor. So these are all the bottom of the branches. Okay, so 675 is 3 squared times 5 squared. 1125 is 3 squared times 5 cubed. All right, so who can remind me of what I need to do for
675?
Thank you. So who can remind me of how to find the greatest common factor? What am I doing? Hayden?
You take the two numbers and they're the same. If they got integers above them, you take the smallest integer.
Good. So I'm looking at the prime factors of each and I'm taking them to the smallest power, right? Prime factors that are in both to the smallest power. So 3 is a prime factor that's in both. The smallest power is squared. 5 is a prime factor that's in both, the smallest power is squared. So that tells me what my GCD is, right? So that equals 3 squared times 5 squared, which equals 225. So 225 divides both of these. It's the largest number that divides both. Somebody told me that when I met with the education person, this is a concept that she observed a teacher teaching
in a middle school math class.
So education majors, you do need to know this. Does somebody have a question?
Do we all need to add or do it out to 225, or can we leave it?
If you do 3 squared times 5 squared, that's fine.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, especially because in those dollar store calculators, 3 cubed can, you got to make sure you're hitting the butt, you know? So I get it. But as long as you're doing the prime factors to the lowest power. Okay? So did you guys feel good about the GCD? Greatest common divisor. All right, let's do another definition. The least common multiple. So, those quizzes, how much of your grade are they worth?
5%.
5%. So if you're not here, you can't take the quiz, right? The only way you can miss a quiz and not have it graded is if you're gone because of sports or if you have a doctor's note. Like if you had to go to the doctor that day because you were really sick. If you're sick and you just can't get up, that's a bummer. So make sure you're here. And I usually try to do it related to stuff we're doing in class. They're not supposed to be super hard, right? So it's, are you paying attention? Did you take the notes? Can you repeat what we just did, right? I think in my college algebra class, I gave a quiz that included things about the syllabus. Do you have your syllabus with you? It was open notes before, right? Somebody had a question?
Yeah, so if I'm like sitting in bed throwing up, I gotta go get a doctor's note just for you to realize that I was sick.
Yeah.
Like I had motto last year, and my teacher did not excuse me from class. That was like,
listen, by having this attendance policy, you don't know how many grandmothers' lives I've saved. That's all I have to say. John gets it. I used to get that, oh, I have to go to a funeral. Oh, my grandma passed away. I'm really sorry to hear that, right? But it seemed like every semester before that, I was like, whew, grandparents were dropping left and right. After that happened, I don't think I've heard about anybody's grandma. If it happens, I'm very sorry. Let me know. But I've saved a lot of grandmas. So you got to have the doctor's note, huh?
What if it actually does happen?
Then we can talk about it. I had a kid who had to fly home to Sydney for something like that. Okay, like, I get it. But the thing is like, you have to have a doctor's note, right? I'm sick, but I'm still at work. Dude, I can hear you. I can hear, and that sarcasm just was like a punch in the face. Huh?
Can you go to the wellness center for that?
You can go to the wellness center, yeah.
For doctors.
Yeah. You don't need to go to the ER. If you have mono, I got a note from some kid that said, like, this student's been in 3 times in the past 2 weeks. He's been having a hard time. Cool. Because I think mono was kind of going around, right?
Yeah. So, like, what do I teach you to not let me, like, miss and, like, I mean, I thought it was supposed to miss me, I would, like, die. My neck was humongous.
Okay. Zane said that maybe we could take a picture with the casket, if that's what works for you.
One last selfie with the camera.
You're right, my rules are silly, you got me. Okay, let's do the LCM. the least common multiple, or the LCM of two. You guys think you're whispering? Like, you're like almost.
No, just how sick I've had my body take a bit of your beef throwing up, so I could prove to
you. Dude, when I was pregnant with my first daughter, I was throwing up nonstop and I was still teaching class.
Well, does that mean you're never going to cancel class because you're sick?
Unless I'm going to the doctor, I'm not canceling class. You have to show up for work.
What about if your kids are sick?
Your kids are sick.
My kid's sick. We took her to the doctor on Thursday at noon instead of at 8 a.m. Huh? Happy for you. I did cancel class once last semester because both my girls were sick, and they were really sick, and they were having a really hard time. I hope it doesn't happen either.
That wasn't sarcasm.
But they're both sick now. We took them to the doctor on Thursday. They're with their father. It's okay. It's not like they're both just really struggling. But, you know, okay. So anyways, the quizzes, be here, right? That was how this all started. Okay, so it's 5% of your grade. It's an easy 5% of your grade, but you have to be here to get that 5%, right? Okay, so the least common multiple, or LCM, of two natural numbers is the smallest number that is a multiple of both. So we did the largest divisor, and this is the smallest multiple. So let's see how we find it. So to find the LCM, we multiply the prime factors to the highest power that appear in either. Whoa. Okay, so the prime factors to the highest power that appear in either. Before, we were only looking at the prime factors that appeared in both, right? Now we're looking at the prime factors that appear in either. Okay, so let's do an example. What number is this? 8. So the LCM of 600 and... 600 and 540. Okay, so the steps for this are the same. We have to do the prime factorization of both numbers, but we already did 600 and 540. Who can remind me? 600 is what?
6 and 10 and 2 and 5.
So we wrote it down on a previous page. So who can give me the summary? It's 2 to the what power? 3. Okay, and 540 was what?
2 squared times 3 cubed times 5.
Okay, so now let's go through. We're looking for the prime factors to the highest power that appear in either. So 2 is in either. I need 2 to the highest power. That's 2 cubed. 3 is in either. I need it to the highest power. So that's 3 cubed. 5 is in either, so I need 5 to the highest power, and that's what it is. Okay, so that means the least common multiple equals this, which if you put it in your calculator, it's 5,400. Okay, so let's do LCM of 20 and 24. who can remind me, we already did the prime factorization of both. 20 was 2 squared times 5. What was 24? 3 cubed times 3. Okay, so write it down. Do what you think. The prime factors to the highest power that appear in either. So write it down. Sorry, this should be 2 cubed. What do you guys think? So, 2, that's a prime factor that appears in either. I'm going to write 2 to the highest power. 3 is a prime factor that appears in either. The highest power that occurs is to the first power. 5 is a prime factor that appears in either. 5, the highest power on 5 is 5. So that is my LCM, and that multiplied together equals 120. Okay? So the prime factor that appear in either to the highest power. Okay?
So it's kind of like with union, how it's either.
Yeah. That's a good way to think about it. So the greatest common divisor was like the intersection, right? The overlap, what's in both. And that's why you have to do it to the least power, right? And then the least common multiple is anything, right? You're just kind of combining them. But I don't need 2 squared and 2 cubed, right? You're just taking the highest power. When I spoke to the person from the education department, she said that one of the student teachers was teaching this, and that's exactly how she did it with a Venn diagram. All right, so let's do another. So the LCM of 66 and 110. So the way that this would be asked on the test is find this. Solve this. You have to know this means the LCM between the number 66 and the number 110. You have to know that part of it is to write out the factor tree, the prime factorization. All right, somebody's going to walk me through it. So we did the GCD for the quiz, but this is the LCM. So the prime factorization is exactly the same. That's why we're redoing it. So 66, who can walk me through it? Aiden, can you tell me the prime factorization of 66 and 110?
Yes. So it is, for 66, it's 11, 3, and 2.
Uh-huh.
And for 110, it's 11, 2, and 5.
Okay, who wants to tell me the LCM? 330.
330?
Yeah. How'd you get that? Good, so it's the prime factors that appear in either to the highest power. So 2 appears, 2 to the highest power, 3 and 5 appear, and 11 appears. 11 appears in both. The highest power is first power still. So 2 times 3 times 5 times 11. What did you say it was, 33? 330? Yep. Like, did people make stuff up?
How did they come up with that formula to do this?
Yeah.
So I think part of a lot of math is figuring out a process, right? Figuring out a process to solve different things. So that's when you come up with definitions, and that's when you come up with, okay, step one, step two, step three. Like, this is how you should do these. So a lot of people say, like, you're coming up with an algorithm. Means you're coming up with a process. You're algorithmatizing the process. You're coming up with the process, the step-by-step. And a lot of that is really used in industry, right? It's used in a lot of industry. How, right, like that's how the Industrial Revolution kind of came about. What's the process to building a car? Well, step one is build this part. Step two is put that part with, right? So it's figuring out the step-by-step of stuff. And once you can do that, it makes things a lot easier. So some of the stuff is used for, we're doing this ahead of adding and subtracting fractions because we're going to need to find a common denominator. So we're going to use this for that. That's the biggest application I can think of right now. But a lot of relationships between numbers, between different sets of numbers right here, we're talking about the natural numbers. We're looking at the relationship between natural numbers, the relationship between rational numbers. Sometimes stuff is different, right? So that's why it's important to define the set of the set that you're looking at first before you just come up with stuff. You know that people used to get PhDs in math for finding the next smallest prime number? That used to be a thing.
When?
Not that long ago.
Really?
Did they discontinue it or something?
Well, now there's computers that can just do it, right? I mean, but it used to be a big thing. People would just sit there and write stuff out. That's where some of those division rules came, or the divisibility rules that we talked about come in, right? People were looking for stuff, and they noticed those patterns. Before a calculator, like how did you divide a 10, 12-digit number by 7? I don't know, you took a day and wrote it all down, right? So I think calculators, I mean, I had a teacher in high school, I don't know how old she was, but she said like these calculators, it didn't exist when she was in high school, right? So we do have a lot of technology that makes things a lot easier, right? Nowadays. I think there was just something about, I read on the news maybe last year about how a Google employee used the Google Cloud, the computing capabilities to figure out, I don't know, the 6 million places of pi, the decimals of pi, right?
Is that going on forever?
Yes.
Okay.
So pi is irrational, right? It cannot be written as a fraction. I think a lot of people use 22 over 7 sometimes in high school as pi. That's an approximation. But pi, where does pi come from? Well, it's an approximation. It's not great. 22 over 7, that's 22. I mean, that's how maybe... I mean, it's kind of close, right? 2.14 or something.
Yeah.
But you can't write pi as a decimal. Maybe they discontinued talking about that at some point. Once there was the pi button.
No, we used something different. It was like 3 point something by a decimal.
Yeah. I mean, see, it's not really a great approximation. It's only to the second decimal, right? Not really even worth talking about. Where does pi come from? No, it was known. Ancient Egyptians. What is pi? You guys are just walking around using pi all through high school and you have no idea?
Yeah. But that's all I have to be thinking or doing.
Doesn't it deal with a circle?
It has to do with a circle.
Oh, yeah.
Right? You use pi in the area of a circle.
Oh, to find the circumference of the diameter.
The unit circle.
No.
You use it in any circle. But how do you get pi? Where does pi come from? Pi is a ratio. It's the ratio of the circumference of the circle over the diameter of a circle. And it's constant for every circle. So ancient Egyptians, long time ago, people were trying to compute the areas of different things, right? Areas, volumes, it's very helpful for construction. And so they noticed this trend, and it helped them compute the area of a circle, volume of a sphere, things like that. So it's the ratio of the circumference of the circle over the diameter. And it's always that number, no matter what circle you have. But a lot of math is usually guided by whatever's being discovered. Did you guys ever watch, what's that NASA show? That NASA movie with the women who did all those Hidden Figures. Have you guys seen that? That's a great movie. It's about... I've been teaching yet.
Yeah.
Huh? Uh-huh. So you guys saw Hidden Figures, right?
Yes.
Who was the woman? You guys should see Hidden Figures won like Oscars and stuff, right?
Yeah.
And it's based on a true story of these African American women. I think there were about four of them. Three of them, okay, who worked at NASA,
yeah.
But it was like 50s, 60s, so they were not given credit as much as they should have been, right?
Yes.
But they basically...
And she was given credit.
Yeah, not at the time.
She was won like the prize, didn't she?
What prize?
The math prize.
Huh? Anyways, but I think later, right?
Yeah, I don't think it was right away.
No, I don't think it was right away. But because of the civil rights issues, right? But those three women basically did all of the computations to like land people on the moon, right? I think just recently it was either India or China, or I'm not exactly sure. They tried to land a rover on the dark side of the moon. So the issue with the dark side of the moon is you can't have any satellite communication. So you have to do all those computations. It's like physics and math computations to make them land, right? Which is what happened in the 50s and 60s. I think it was Katherine Johnson, right?
Yes.
Katherine Johnson. That's what she was doing because there's a delay. I think it was, I don't know, a couple minutes delay. And then recently what happened within the last year, trying to land on the dark side of the moon, they crashed, right? The calculations were a little off. Super sorry.
Very expensive mistake.
Yeah.
Huh?
So I gotta know negative one squared is one, right? Wouldn't that be embarrassing? Okay, but I think the math is developed around what is being explored. So space exploration brought about a bunch of different math. You guys, are any of you guys business economics majors? I think economics has really only been around since the 50s. I heard a news clip on the radio about how there was the Fed? It's the federal government, Federal Reserve. They set a lot of economic policy and interest rates and a bunch of stuff like that. There was one economist working at the Fed in the 50s or 60s, and they all thought, like, economics was a joke field. My husband did economics in grad school, and he had friends who graduated who... I mean, if you're in the economics business department, you're making twice as much as math people. Because now it's so valued. But it's a new field, right? I mean, calculus, how old is calculus? A couple hundred years. That's it, right? People are like, how do you do math research? What? I mean, calculus is such a standardized course now, but been around since Newton. What was that, 1600s ish, something?
Wouldn't there be economics back when, like, there's the stock exchange and stuff?
So it wasn't. It. I think the field wasn't as well respected. It wasn't. I mean, the ideas have been around, right? But, like, having it be like a major or having that be like your specialty, I think is, that's what I heard from this thing on the radio. There was one economist. Now, I don't know if you can get a job at the Fed without being an economist. I would say the majority of the people are there now. But it wasn't viewed as like a respected field not that long ago, right? So a lot of the stuff you're learning might be pretty new, right? And is still developing. And it's really up to whatever's happening in the world, and it's really up to you guys to see where it goes next, right? So we might be doing the LCM, and it seems like, who came up with this? It might be somebody a million years ago, right? But these are the basic building blocks of things that you guys will be learning, right? Okay. You guys really get me to go off on tangents. So.
What section is this?
What section? I think 6.1. Okay. So we did some examples of finding the GCD and finding the LCM, right? What's the relationship between them? So fact. Well, let's look. Let's see if we can figure out what the fact is. Let's look at the GCD of 66 and 110 and the LCM of 66 and 110. What were those again? The LCM was 330. And what was the GCD? Twenty-two. Okay, so here's the GCD, here's the LCM, here's the numbers. Do you guys see a relationship?
You can divide one by the other.
What's 66 times 110?
690.
So 66 times 110 equals, what is it?
72,260.
Okay.
Oh, no. 7,260, I'm sorry.
This?
Yeah.
Okay. What's 22 times 330? Yeah. So that's the relationship. So if you get to a test and you want to check your answers, if you multiply the numbers together and you multiply the GCD and the LCM, they should be the same. And that's because of the idea that Andrew noticed about kind of Venn diagrams. Okay, so fact. The GCD of two numbers, A and B, times the LCM of two numbers, A and B, equals A times B. Yeah. So that's a way you can check your work, right? That's a way to check your work on a test. Okay. All right, so now let's start section 6.2, the integers. So what are the integers again? Who can tell me in set notation? The natural numbers are the counting numbers. What are the integers? Good. So you have to have the dot, dot, dot on the left and on the right to say it continues like that forever. You have to show a negative, you have to show zero, you have to show positives. Yep, that's set notation. That's the set of integers, right? Okay? So adding and subtracting, adding and subtracting. Adding and subtracting integers. We know how to add and subtract integers, right? Should I do an example? I'm going to do an example. 1 plus 4.
3.
1 minus 4.
3.
What is it?
-3.
So don't laugh too soon, friends. -1 minus 4.
-5.
Everybody laughs when I say 1 plus 4, and they think it's silly. But let's talk about the negatives, right? So if you think about it on a number line, subtraction is moving to the left, right? Negative numbers, if I start at -1 and I subtract 4, I move to the left 4, right? If I have -1 minus -4, subtraction goes to the left, a negative number goes to the left, so I'm going to the left, I can't go to the left twice, so that's when subtracting a negative number actually becomes addition. So subtraction is usually to the left, negatives are usually to the left, but because I have two negatives, you go to the right. So this is actually addition right here. Let me write that as a step. Huh? So let me rewrite it with subtracting a negative becomes addition. So I have -1 plus 4 is 3. Okay, how do you do this on the Cheapola calculator? You can go 1. How do you do a negative number on this calculator? Can you do that? What do you do? 1, 1. I don't know how to do it on this calculator. Does anybody know how to do it on this calculator? You're helping your friends for the next test. Because I heard a lot of people say 1 minus 4, they weren't sure. Here, you can do 1 minus 4 is -3, right?
Yeah.
But how do I put in a negative number? But see, that was not right, what I just did. If I typed in 1 minus -4, I think you just have to know this rule. Subtracting a negative. I mean, this one you can type into the calculator, this one you can type into the calculator.
Oh, no, you just press subtract before you press the number.
Yeah, I did 1. See, you know, how do I get...
No, press, like, the actual, like, subtraction. Like, press subtract 1.
3.
And then do your...
I don't know what you're saying.
So, like, let's say we're doing, like, -1 subtracted by 1.
Uh-huh.
So, boom, boom.
I can't see the boom.
Click the subtraction number and then the subtraction button. Click the subtraction button and then, so one, that'd be -1 for sure.
Oh, yeah.
No, but it has a little M mark.
Okay, you've got to know this rule. I can't figure this out. You gotta know the rule. This is something you guys should know how to do, but you need to remember how to do. If this shows up on a test and you have this calculator, are you gonna get this right? Because the first example people giggled about. Make sure you're getting number 4 and number 3 correct on a test.
Are we going to have 2 negatives? So that we're supposed to
sure.
Negative.
So right now we're talking about addition and subtraction. Next we will talk about multiplication and division. Okay, so let's do a definition. Two integers. Again, integers, our examples are up top. Our set notation is up top. Two integers, A and B, are said to be additive inverses. If and only if A plus B equals 0. Pardon? Additive inverse. I-N-V-E-R-S-E-S. Additive inverses. Let me see if I can write that a little bit more clearly. Additive inverses. If A plus B equals 0, can you give me an example? What two numbers are additive inverses? You add them together and they equal 0. Negative 1 and positive 1 are additive inverses. Good.
So you have to have a negative and a positive.
Correct. In order to equal 0. So here we're talking about the integers. We did not talk about additive inverses when we talked about the natural numbers. And that's because you do not have additive inverses in the natural numbers, right? I can't add anything to 3 to get 0. If I'm talking about the natural numbers, because I don't have 0 in the natural numbers, even, and I don't have negatives, right? So I don't have additive inverses in the natural numbers. I do have additive inverses in the integers. So again, it's really important to know the set you're working within so you can know the properties of that set. Let's do B. Multiplication and division. Okay? Let's do an example. What's 2 times 3? 6. What's negative 2 times 3? Negative 6. What's 2 times negative 3? Negative 6. What's negative 2 times negative 3? 6. Okay, I just chose 2 and 3. I could have said A and B. When I say A and B, it's a little trickier for people to understand. But if they're the same sign, they equal a positive number. If they're opposite signs, they equal a negative number, right? Okay, so let's write that. So rules. If A and B are integers, this is a challenge with math too, is you might get a definition, you might get a theorem, but like put that into an example to make sure you understand it, right? So I did the easy example that you guys are accustomed to seeing, that you guys are still laughing a little bit about, that we're doing in this class, but it's so that we can talk about A and B now. Because A and B are just any integers. Okay? A and B are any integers. So A, if A and B are the same sign, then A times B, what does this mean? What? Greater than 0 means it's positive, right? Okay? So if A and B are the same sign, then A times B is greater than 0. So this is counting on A and B are not equal to 0, right? So I'm going to say greater than or equal to 0. How about?
What is that?
This?
Yeah.
This you have. Greater than or equal to? Oh, I did it at an angle?
Yeah.
Oh. Okay. So B, if A and B are opposite signs, then A times B is less than 0. A times B is a negative number, right? We just did these examples up top. I could say less than or equal to if I wanted to include. I mean, 0 doesn't really have a sign, right? 0 could be negative 0, positive 0. So I'll do the less than or equal to just to, if you want to think about 0. But we don't really talk about the sign of 0. Okay. Okay, so that's it. So we finished 6.1 in class today, so I'm going to make 6.1 due Friday. Okay, so you guys look at it before next class and bring your questions. Today's Thursday? Oh, today's Thursday, so I'll make it due next week Tuesday. So bring your questions to class on Tuesday. I have office hours now if you guys have any questions about your grades, any questions about assignments, quizzes, whatever.